I will make you understand.
On the 19th of July in 2011, the National Press Club of Australia held a debate on climate change. It was a debate between Richard Dennis and Lord Christopher Monckton. Dr. Dennis is the Executive Director of the Australia Institute and an adjunct professor with Australian National University. During the debate, he defended and represented the scientific consensus on global warming and climate change. Christopher Monckton is a well-known climate skeptic and chief policy advisor to the Science and Public Policy Institute. As such, he argued against the current consensus and gave his arguments for why he thinks the science is wrong. I will be giving an analysis of the claims made by Monckton during this debate with Dr. Dennis and check if they are correct or incorrect. The reason I'm doing this is that Monckton challenges his critics to check his sources, or like he put it in this debate, to do your homework.
Please, will you do your homework?
I'm going to follow him up on this to see if the scientific literature and other available sources corroborate what he's saying. A full transcript of this video is available on my website, realskeptic.com. The transcript has been split up into different claims made by Monckton and are listed in chronological order. On the page for each individual claim, you'll also find a full listing of all the sources I used for that particular section of the video. That being said, I hope you'll find this video interesting and informative.
I'll now invite Lord Monckton to make his opening remarks. Lord Monckton, please.
My lords, that's me. Ladies and gentlemen, the climate, like the cricket, is chaotic. Who would have believed that England would not only win back the Ashes, but would then hang on to them the next time round? Just thought I'd rub it in. Now, because the climate is chaotic, or even if it isn't, it acts as though it were, it is not predictable in the long term. And that, if you do science by consensus, and that was the central argument that Professor Dennis offered us today, that there is a consensus. If you do climate by consensus, then the consensus is expressed in the documents of IPCAC, the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change. And they say that the climate is a coupled, non-linear, chaotic object, and that therefore the long-term prediction of future climate states is not possible.
This is a very strange statement, as the IPCC has included projections about what our future climate might look like in every single report they published. They even give different types of outcomes depending on the amount of greenhouse gases we emit. But he actually seems to be quoting from the 2001 IPCC report. One of the places this is mentioned is in the section 14.2.2.2, balancing the need for final scales and the need for assemblies. The Working Group 1 report, and it says the following. In climate research and modeling, we should recognize that we are dealing with a coupled, nonlinear, chaotic system, and therefore that the long-term prediction of future climate states is not possible. The most we can expect to achieve is the prediction of the probability distribution of the system's future possible states by the generation of assemblies of model solutions. If you read the entire section, you will find that they mention computational restrictions as one of the reasons that limits them in the amount of detail they can include in the models. And let's not forget all the other factors that make it hard to project what happens. For example, how much CO2 we emit, as this hinges on economic, social, and technological developments. Because of reasons like these, it is not possible to give the one most likely scenario for how events will play out, its consequences, and what the eventual future climate will be. But it doesn't mean that you can't predict what might happen given a certain scenario. The IPCC explains this in, for example, section 1.2.2, Natural Variability of Climate, of the Working Group 1 report. Many processes and interactions in the climate system are nonlinear. That means that there is no simple proportional relation between cause and effect. A complex, nonlinear system may display what is technically called chaotic behavior. This means that the behavior of the system is critically dependent on very small changes of the initial conditions. This does not imply, however, that the behavior of nonlinear chaotic system is entirely unpredictable, contrary to what is meant by chaotic in colloquial language. It has, however, consequences for the nature of its variability and the predictability of its variations. The daily weather is a good example. The evolution of weather systems responsible for the daily weather is governed by such nonlinear chaotic dynamics. This does not preclude successful weather prediction. In other words, what they say here, and throughout the entire report, is that complex systems like the climate can be predicted. We just have to be aware of where the limitations are and how we should deal with them, which is a far cry from saying that our future climate cannot be predicted. An illustration of what I mean with these uncertainties, one of them being climate noise, is given by Ben Center, one of the IPCC authors.
This is from a climate model, a Japanese climate model. These are from experiments that were performed in support of the IPCC's fourth assessment report in 2007. What you see here are tropospheric temperature time series, and you can see that there's this black line here is this small overall warming trend. This is an experiment where a model is driven by changes in greenhouse gases, changes in the sun's energy output, changes in aerosols, ozone. We call them also colloquially, everything and the kitchen sink experiments, where you try and drive a climate model with your best estimate of the actual factors that have been important over the 20th century. And you can calculate from this climate model something akin to the satellite temperatures that I've showed you. And in this particular run of this Japanese model, you have a La Niña, that's that blue thing, near the end, which tends to cool it down. And you have an El Niño near the beginning, that's the red thing, which tends to warm things up. Because this is a short record, only a little over 20 years, and you have a warm blip near the beginning and a cool blip near the end, you don't get much overall change. Now, when you run the same model, but starting from a different initial state, back, say, in 1850 or so, you get some different sequence of El Niños and La Niñas. These are free-running models, if you will. They generate their own climate noise. And if you start from different initial conditions, very soon you get a different sequence of El Niños and La Niñas. You see that very clearly here. This is, again, the same model, the same human-caused forcing factors that it's being run with, but it has a different sequence of El Niños. In this case, it has an El Niño near the end of the series and a La Niña near the beginning, so it shows a larger overall warming trend because it has a cool blip near the beginning and a warm blip near the end. And you can see the same thing here. This is the same model, just different realizations. And each one of them has a slightly different sequence of wiggles, ups and downs, different overall trends. This is the effect of noise. This is climate noise. Obviously, in the real world, we don't have the luxury of rerunning the real world many times. We only have one sequence of climate noise and one sequence of how the real world has responded to human-caused changes in greenhouse gases. But in the climate model world, you can essentially sort of rerun the 20th century many times and get many different sequences of these things. And what you do then at the end is you average over all of these things. You average over these five realizations, and that beats down the noise because the noise is not correlated from one realization to the next. So you get a better estimate of the thing you're really interested in, which is the slow overall increase in temperature, in this case, in response to human-caused changes in greenhouse gases and all that other nice stuff.
So the IPCC report doesn't say they can't predict future climate states, as they can and do give predictions for likely future climate states. Also, I find it odd he's giving a direct quote from the IPCC 2001 report, when the report published in 2007 is the most recent one, which also gives a similar statement about our chaotic climate system and what this means for predictions, albeit updated with the latest research.
The Royal Society, in a complete rewrite of its original disastrously unscientific statement about the climate, now says we do not know how much the planet will warm as a result of our activities.
Monckton is most likely referring to the document climate change guide that was released by the Royal Society in September 2010, and several other contrarians and so-called skeptics have made similar claims about it. This claim has its probable genesis from sentences like the one in the second paragraph of the introduction where they state the following. The size of future temperature increases and other aspects of climate change, especially at the regional scale, are still subject to uncertainty. They expand on this in paragraph 40 in the section Future Climate Change, and it states, "As with almost any attempts to forecast future conditions, projections of future climate change depend on a number of factors. Future emissions due to human activity will depend on social, technological, and population changes which cannot be known with confidence. The underlying uncertainties in climate science and the inability to predict precisely the size of future natural climate forcing mechanisms mean that projections must be made which take into account a range of uncertainties across these different areas. The 2007 assessment by the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, IPCC, made projections of future changes using a number of possible scenarios of future emissions, based on a diverse range of assumptions. The IPCC's best estimate was that globally average surface temperatures would be between 2.5 to 4.7 Celsius higher by 2100 compared to pre-industrial levels. The full range of projected temperature increases by 2100 was found to be 1.8 to 7.1 Celsius based on the various scenarios and uncertainties in climate sensitivity." So they actually do give a most likely increase in temperature in the document they've released. And their statements reflect what has been written in the IPCC documents.
"And the idea that you decide any scientific question by mere consensus is opposed by the philosophers of science from Aristotle 2,400 years ago to Al-Haytham, the founder of the scientific method in 11th century Iraq, to Karl Popper in 1934 in the celebrated paper that formalized the scientific method as an iterative algorithm. In none of these people's opinion is science, or was it, or will it ever be, decided by consensus. As Einstein himself said when replying to a book by the Nazis, who regarded his science as Jewish science and they wished to attack it, and they had 100 scientists against Einstein, he said, if there is something wrong with my theory, one paper will be enough to set the entire theory aside. You won't need 100 scientists. So merely counting heads, the argumentum ad populum, merely saying that various scientific societies are august, the argumentum ad verecundiam, the arguments from headcount fallacy and reputation fallacy respectively, are not proper scientific arguments."
He's right. Science isn't done by consensus. But there is a consensus view on what the science says based on our best understanding of the available evidence. Just like there is a consensus view on the subject of anthropogenic global warming, there is one for evolution, plate tectonics, Big Bang, germ theory, in all the scientific fields and subjects. And that is what Richard Dennis was referring to when he said the following.
"So let me start with an analogy. Imagine that you went to the doctor, and I hope this doesn't happen, but imagine that you were diagnosed with a skin cancer. And the doctor, having diagnosed this skin cancer, suggested an intense and rapid treatment. The treatment unpleasant and potentially expensive, but the prognosis was good. Now that's bad news, and you might wish that it were other, so you might get a second opinion. You go to see another doctor, they confirm the diagnosis. You see a third doctor, you see a fourth doctor, they all confirm the diagnosis. But after after shopping around for long enough, spending more time while the cancer potentially spreads, you finally find a doctor who advises you that you don't have cancer, and even if you did have cancer, chemotherapy and radiotherapy are unlikely to work. There's plenty of evidence on the internet to suggest that herbal remedies would be far more effective. What would you do? What would you do? There are people out there telling you don't act. There are people out there saying the solutions won't work. But how would you, as a person, make a decision under such uncertainty? Now, I reckon most people would go with the science. And I think it's, call me old-fashioned, but I think it's just common sense. And I certainly suspect that our children and our family would encourage us to take the cautious route and listen to the science, not the optimistic route that perhaps the science is wrong and anyway, maybe the treatments don't work.
It's not a simple argumentum ad populum if you point out that 97% of publishing climate scientists agree, based on the scientific literature, that we are causing the planet to warm. Also, it's not an argumentum ad verecundium, an argument from authority, when you point out that almost all scientific organizations reflect and confirm this consensus. If that would invalidate what these scientists and organizations are saying, it would also invalidate the consensus on evolution, a subject where there is also an almost unanimous agreement that biological evolution is a principle of nature that has been well established by science. You can disagree with the consensus, but it's then up to you to prove with research why the current understanding of that scientific subject is wrong, and provide a hypothesis that fits the evidence better, something opponents of the current consensus view haven't been able to do. And it's not because climate researchers don't listen to criticism. Far from it, as Dr. Richard Allais showed with his testimony before a congressional hearing.
And how do we know it's we, not nature? We've got the increase in CO2, but the skeptic would argue, well, wait a second, I can go back to 1927 and find articles about glaciers retreating. What's the difference? I mean, you know, you could look at a football team and say, well, they were losing back then and they're losing now, so what's the difference?
Right. So the first one is the physics. We just cannot get away from the warming effect of CO2. It's been known for over a century. It was really clarified by the Air Force, who were actually interested in what wavelength should I use for the sensor on my heat-seeking missile. But CO2 interacts with radiation, and there's enough CO2 to make a difference. And we just can't get away from that physics. The second one is looking at, is there any other possible thing to explain this? And it really took, I'm sorry, sir, it took a few billion dollars of your money and about 30 years to say that there's nothing else that we can find in nature to do this. And this is because satellites are expensive. But someone says it's the sun. Well, then you need a satellite to watch the sun to see if the sun is getting brighter, but it isn't. And if someone says, well, it's volcanoes, then we need a history of volcanoes, and we need to know what they're doing. And if someone says it's cosmic rays, we need cosmic ray monitors. And it's taken sort of 30 years to get to the point of saying, no, we've looked really hard. We can't find anything else. Then there's a third piece, which is the fingerprinting, which is what Dr. Santer was discussing. If you were to say, okay, yeah, I know we spend a lot of money on satellites, and the satellites say the sun is not getting brighter, but maybe the satellites are wrong, and the sun's getting brighter, and we can't see it. That makes a prediction. It gets warmer down here, and it gets warmer way up at the top of the stratosphere. CO2 says warmer, colder. What's going on? Warmer, colder. So the fingerprinting in time and in space says that we got it right on the other two pieces. It's mostly us now.
This was a perfect explanation by Dr. Richard Allais about how they have made sure they got it right. And not only that they listen to critics and investigate if they have a point. That's how climate research works. That's how scientific research works.
The sort of questions that you might have asked, and perhaps should ask in a free country, are these. You might have asked, I wonder why the usual suspects cry consensus when it is so clear in the history of science that consensus is not the way science is done. Why does official climate science still pretend the Middle Ages were not warmer than the present, when the fabricators of the 2001 UN report's purported abolition of the medieval warm period are now under criminal investigation for defrauding taxpayers by tampering with data and results?
The medieval warm period Monckton is referring to was between 950 and 1250 AD, and is indeed a reference to a warm period in our planet's history. However, our current understanding is this wasn't a global phenomenon. It was predominantly in the Northern Hemisphere, and even though this warming was most pronounced in the Northern Hemisphere, There were also places in the Northern Hemisphere that were significantly colder than today. We know this because of the work done by, for example, Michael Mann. We use more than 1,000 tree ring, ice core, coral, sediment, and several other temperature proxy records to create a global temperature record spanning 1,000 years. This record spans both hemispheres, and the temperature graph very clearly shows that globally it wasn't warmer than today. Compared to today's temperature records, in red, it's quite clear that it is now much warmer than during the medieval warm period. This is a graph that is known as the hockey stick graph, and has been under heavy fire by people like Monckton who say it's flawed. Problem is, there is now a team of hockey stick graphs all telling the same story, and confirming the groundbreaking work Michael Mann did with his original research. Now the abolishment Monckton was referring to is that in early reports this warm period was shown as a global warm period, a reflection of our then current understanding in science and available temperature reconstructions. When the reconstruction of Mann became available, it showed this wasn't a global phenomenon, and the 2001 IPCC report just reflected this new scientific knowledge. There is also a second claim made by Monckton, which is the following.
When the fabricators of the 2001 UN report's purported abolition of the medieval warm period are now under criminal investigation for defrauding taxpayers by tampering with data and results.
What he's implying is that these scientists are being investigated by a law enforcement agency for some scientific misconduct and subsequent fraud. But I hadn't heard of anything like this, so I asked Monckton what he was referring to. Before I start with his answer, remember this date, the 19th of July 2011. This was when the debate was held. You will see why this is important in a moment. And this is what Monckton said to me. The Attorney General of the State of Virginia announced some time ago that he was investigating the role of the University of Virginia and of at least one scientist there, whom he named under the Fraud Against Taxpayer Act of 2000 in that state. The investigation Monckton is referring to is the Attorney General of Virginia's Climate Science Investigation, initiated by the Virginia Attorney General Ken Cuccinelli. It was a civil fraud investigation of 5 research grant applications by former University of Virginia professor Michael Mann. The reason Cuccinelli started this was because he thought that the ClimateGate email showed scientific fraud. To further investigate it, he issued a demand to the University of Virginia to turn over records related to Michael Mann and his grants. The judge dismissed this case on the 30th of August in 2010 as Cuccinelli didn't give any evidence that there might have been fraud involved. Furthermore, 4 of the 5 grants couldn't even be prosecuted on the 2003 Virginia Fraud Against Taxpayers Act as they preceded its enactment. Cuccinelli resubmitted his request, now with just the 1 grant being mentioned, but basically with the same wording. Now the problem is, as he's using the same wording again, is that there have been 8 investigations into the ClimateGate emails. None of them have found any evidence for scientific fraud in the hacked emails. Monckton is technically correct in saying that there is a fraud investigation in the case of Michael Mann. However, this is the only one, and there is just one person involved. So his claim that the fabricators of the 2001 UN reports are now under criminal investigation for defrauding taxpayers by tampering with data and results is not entirely correct. All of this was already known before the debate that Monckton held, so he had to be aware that the case as is wouldn't be a strong one, considering this case was already dismissed in 2010 and the 8 investigations already showed that the scientists did their work correctly. And as I expected, the last remaining case was ruled in favor of Michael Mann on the 12th of March in 2012, with the Virginia Supreme Court saying that Cuccinelli did not have a case and didn't have the authority under the Fraud Against Taxpayer Act to make civil investigation demands. Monckton did also mention something else he sees as fraud, a statistically fraudulent technique, but I'll talk about that when he mentions it in the debate.
I wonder why the published version of the 1995 UN report, written by just one man, stated the exact opposite of the scientists' final draft, which had said 5 times that no human influence on global temperature was either discernible or immediately foreseeable.
I don't know why you would say that the 1995 report was written by one man, as it most definitely wasn't. Every report lists the name of all the authors, contributors, and anyone else that was involved in the creation of the report. And it's quite a substantial listing, as demonstrated by the listed names for just one chapter. Now, it could be that he simply misspoke, as his original argument on this was the following.
And now watch this. Here is what the bureaucrats did. They rewrote the final draft yet again, after it had been cleared and signed off by the scientists, to say the exact opposite. The body of evidence now points to a discernible human influence on climate. And that has been the official line ever since.
In both cases, he says that the published report doesn't say what the scientists wrote in the final draft. This is simply not true. But there is a reason Monckton mentioned this. I'll let Professor Stephen Snyder explain the genesis of this claim.
So over the years, we all did our quiet work that nobody really paid any attention to. And in 1994, the IPCC, the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, as all of you know, in its second assessment report, had in Working Group 1 a Chapter 8, whose, I think they called them convening lead authors then, was Ben Santer and Tom Wigley, right? I think it was both of you guys. No, just you. Okay. That meant he was responsible for the chapter. And that chapter was based on a paper that Ben led a team of people on looking for fingerprints. He'll explain that in the system. I gave you guys examples of them very quickly on the fly, but that's the guy who really did it first. And those fingerprints basically pointed to a discernible impact of human activities on climate. This triggered a massively ugly scene at the, it was the first massively ugly scene in the IPCC history at a plenary, which is where the 100 governments get together and have to approve the summary for policymakers word for word. And the guy being attacked was him. So it was because this chapter saying there was this discernible impact, though that word came out later in the, but you know, to that effect. And the chief Saudi negotiator basically said this was bad science, tried to drive a wedge between North and South countries, was very effectively doing it, and there was what is called a contact group. At a contact group, when you cannot agree in plenary, you go off and you negotiate. We negotiated like all day to get this language right. Now the Saudis, who made all the fuss, and the Kuwaitis never sent anybody, and they had many, many, many delegates. This one guy from Kenya came, and he had actually proposed dropping the entire chapter because he believed the Saudis. This was the Southern Solidarity. But this guy, meteorologist, not a famous science star, came and he watched this entire day, changed his mind, decided the process was fair and open. So we go back, and the normal practice in IPCC after a contact group where the group agrees is that the text is put up there on the screen, and it is pro forma accepted, because if you started fighting over it again, you'd never get out. Well, of course, Saudis immediately raise their hand, and Al-Saban starts in. This is unacceptable to us. So Ben has the temerity, this mere scientist, to say, but sir, your delegation made the most noise, and you did not even have anybody at the group. And Al-Saban slams his fist on the table and it says, I am a representative of a sovereign country. You're just a scientist. You cannot talk to me like that. And we're a small delegation. We didn't have time. The Kenyan guy raises his flag. My stomach is in knots. And he gets up and he says, I'm a small delegation. I'm it. But I was convinced by the Saudis that this was really important. I went. I'm now satisfied. The lead authors are correct. I withdraw my objection and urge everybody to vote for it. It passed. Then the Wall Street Journal started accusing him. You going to tell about that?
No.
Of scientific cleansing. Because in an IPCC report, every single meeting is correcting the language. So at the direction of the plenary, he corrected the language to which these guys in the Wall Street Journal redacted the components that were one of your words you just taught me, Meg, that were caveats and said, therefore, this was a distortion of that. So there's this Mr. Mild-mannered Ben Santer, the statistician, quiet guy on the block, all of a sudden now out there as this object of derision by these manufactured, trumped-up charges of the ideology of no government control and the fossil fuel industry. Unfortunately for them, Ben very shortly thereafter got a MacArthur Genius Award, not just because he stood up to them, but primarily because this was the first scientific study really showing that there was a discernible impact of human activities on climate by good statistical testing.
So to summarize what Professor Schneider said, the original report always said something to the effect that we are having discernible impact on the climate. And this conclusion, based on the research cited, caused some political controversy during a plenary session at the IPCC. All changes are discussed and approved during these sessions. And after such a session, they agreed on this wording, which was then taken out of context by the media. No shenanigans involved, no strange rewriting of documents, it was just the media incorrectly reporting. Something that is quite easy to verify in public records, considering the other scientists involved spoke out that the media got this wrong.
Or I wonder why the published version of the 2007 UN report deploys a flagrantly fraudulent statistical technique to pretend that the world is warming ever faster and that we are to blame.
Now this was also a claim that I wasn't familiar with, so I followed up with Monckton to clarify what his point was. This is what he said. The fraudulent technique to which I referred during the debate was a superimposition of four distinct trend lines on a thrice-repeated graph of the Hadley Center/Crew global temperature dataset, and the false attempt by the IPCC, in at least three places in its fourth assessment report, to draw the unjustifiable conclusion from the ratios of the slopes of the four trend lines that the Earth is warming ever faster and that we are to blame. With this bit of information I could trace down what his argument is. I'll let Monckton give the detailed explanation.
Here is the latest lie in the 2007 report, the iconic lie there. They're attempting to show that global warming is accelerating. Implication that our CO2 emissions are accelerating and this is causing a more rapid rate of warming. This is a statistical lie known as the start point or end point fallacy, where you take a jiggly uppy-downy data set like temperature, you don't know which way it's going to go next, a stochastic data set. If you choose your start points and your end points carefully enough, you can make it look as though any trend you want is happening. Here they've tried to show a rising trend. I'm now going to take the same data, but I'm going to take the more recent end of it, between 1993 at the present, and I'm going to choose my own start points. Look at this. Top left, 1993 to the present. Top right, 1997 to the present. Bottom left, 2001 to the present, bottom right, 2005 to the present. We're heading for a new ice age.
And he's right with that. If you pick your own start and or end points, you can most of the time show any trend you want. Especially if you take very short time spans like Monckton did with his examples. The climate is very variable in the short term and that makes it hard to pick up any underlying trends. It's the reason why climate trends are calculated over relatively long periods of, for example, 20 years. That these trends can be misleading is exactly what the IPCC says in the very chapter they showed the chart for the first time. Another low-pass filter, widely used and easily understood, is to fit a linear trend to the time series, although there is generally no physical reason why trends should be linear, especially over long periods. The overall change in the time series is often inferred from the linear trend over the given time period, but can be quite misleading. Such measures are typically not stable and are sensitive to beginning and end points, so that adding or subtracting a few points can result in a marked difference in the estimated trend. One of the reasons they say this is, for example, mentioned in Chapter 3, Observations, Surface and Atmospheric Climate Change, where this graph first appears. It says on page 246, only in the last decade is an overall warming signal clearly emerging. Therefore, the recent strong warming appears to be related in part to the AMO, Atlantic Multidecadal Oscillation, in addition to a global warming signal. What they are referring to with this is that early in the century the human signal wasn't even detectable. In the report itself they say our contribution to the increasing temperatures could only be detected since 1970. This is what makes these linear trends not ideal for taking a look at what our climate is doing. This is exactly the reason why they are not basing any future predictions, claims, or concluding how much we have contributed to increasing temperatures on these linear trends. The actual attribution of this warming happens in, for example, Chapter 9, which is called Understanding and Attributing Climate Change. which uses far more research and sophisticated methods than linear trend lines. So this graph is not used, like Monckton claims, to pretend that the world is warming ever faster and that we are to blame. But there's another part that needs addressing. The claim that this is somehow fraudulent. This was also a point I contacted Monckton for to get further clarification on. And there's a huge problem with his explanation. In his answer to me, he explains that basing their conclusions and projections on linear trends while being pointed out to them that this is incorrect and not correcting the mistake is fraudulent. But the thing is, as I've just explained, they are not basing projections and conclusions on these linear trend lines, and as such it cannot be in any way fraudulent.
And why do we think that we're going to suddenly get 3.3 Celsius for a doubling of CO2 concentration this century, that's the IPCC's central estimate, or 5.1, which is your government's central estimate, when all the science done by measurement and observation rather than by models suggests just 1 Celsius degree?
This is a part of the debate that drew my attention. The 5.1 degrees warming is an actual number used by the Australian government. It is mentioned on their page Global Action, Facts and Fiction. It is also used on other information sites about the carbon tax. This number comes from the 2008 report, the Carnot Climate Change Review, for which also an update was published in 2011. They projected a 5.1 degrees increase in global temperature above 1990 levels by the year 2100, if CO2 emissions aren't reduced. For this they used the same climate sensitivity, in other words, how much temperature would increase for doubling of CO2 in the atmosphere, as the IPCC has in its 2007 report. And they used the same way of calculating this as the IPCC would. Then why the difference in numbers? The reason is that the IPCC assumed we would act on the available science and start reducing our emissions. The number they mention, the 3.3 degrees warming, is based on at least some reduction of our emissions, which is their A2 scenario in the 2007 report. If you take a look at our current emissions, the best apparent fit would indeed be the A2 scenario, which eventually leads to a CO2 level of 1,250 parts per million. This translates to a warming of about 3.4 degrees above the 1990 baseline temperature the IPCC uses. However, we are currently coming very close to the IPCC's most pessimistic scenario, the A1FI, where FI stands for fossil intensive. In this scenario, they project CO2 levels of 1,550 parts per million and a projected temperature increase of about 4 degrees. This is the IPCC scenario that comes close to the 1,600 parts per million the Carnot report uses for their 5.1 degrees increase. This last 1 degree difference is very easily explained. If you take a look at the possible temperature range for the Carnot report projection, you will see it is between 3 degrees and 6.6 degrees. Almost the exact same range the IPCC uses for their A1FI scenario, which is between 2.4 and 6.4 degrees. So this last degree difference comes from how they calculated their best estimate. Calculating this estimate is not an easy thing to do, as we don't have a lot of research on these high CO2 level scenarios, for the simple reason that many scientists thought we would never reach these CO2 levels. It's because of our delayed action that scientists are now doing more research on these scenarios. Similar figures as to what the Carnot report gave are now being mentioned in these results, which is a signal that the IPCC might actually have underestimated the amount of warming. This is not that strange, as their estimate for sea level rise are tracking the upper bounds for their projections, or the loss of Arctic sea ice, which exceeds their worst case scenario. This isn't meant as criticism towards Monckton, as the only thing he does here is mention two projected numbers. He doesn't say anything about its meaning in relation to each other. I talked about this since these two different numbers would raise questions from members in the audience as to why they are different. As such, you should take this as me responding to these questions from the audience. He also talked about what the actual warming would be, which is with its 1 degree of warming by 2100 a lot lower than the 3.3 degrees the IPCC projects. A warming of just 1 degree is extremely unlikely, and research confirms this. We have decades worth of research which has precisely quantified how much energy CO2 can absorb. Because of that, we know how much energy CO2 would absorb in our atmosphere. This is an effect we've been measuring and confirming by satellites and ground-based stations. Another very important point is that climate has changed before on our planet. We can use the trace this has left in the geological record to reconstruct how the climate reacted. This is one of the biggest contributors to our understanding of how our planet responds to increases in CO2 and other greenhouse gases. The vast majority of these findings give a temperature range of about 2 degrees Celsius to 4.5 degrees Celsius warming for a doubling of CO2. All this and much, much more is used for climate models and is the basis for figures mentioned in the IPCC reports. These models themselves are then tested against observed changes in past climates. They are also tested against the direct measurements we have. The results this yields are then scrutinized by scientists worldwide in order to make the models more accurate and fit the real world better. Thanks to this, the models have become quite good. This was just a small sampling of the science involved in determining how our climate will respond. I opened the door a tiny bit, so to speak. As Monckton goes into more detail several times during this debate, I'll expand more on the subject to make it clear that the number he cites is a gross underestimate of what we can expect in the real world.
And then Professor Dennis raised the question of the insurance principle. Just in case there might be a risk of a large asteroid hitting us, we should spend 150% of global GDP from now forever to try to make sure we have a large cricket bat to knock them out of the way again. And in the London insurance market, we have a saying, and that is that if the cost of the premium exceeds the cost of the risk, don't insure. And that brings me to the carbon tax and the mineral resources rent tax. Now, both of these taxes are going to cost more than the cost of letting global warming happen in the first place. One question we should ask is, how much global warming will a 5% reduction in Australia's emissions, which represent in turn 1.2% of global emissions, actually achieve? Well, here's the numbers. 0.06% of world carbon emissions remitted over the next 10 years, and the amount of carbon dioxide that would have been in the atmosphere, according to the IPCC, would fall from, wait for it, 412 to 411.987 parts per million. And this would forestall, wait for it again, 0.00007 Celsius degrees of global warming. This is consensus mainstream calculation. And this is 1/14,000th of a Celsius degree. It is 1/700th of the threshold below which no modern method or instrument can detect any change in global temperature at all.
Monckton is forwarding the argument here that there is no sense in proceeding with reducing CO2 emissions if it is only Australia. It is true that if nobody else around the world is doing it, no single country can make a significant dent in global CO2 emissions. But there are several problems with this. Australia isn't alone. For example, the European Union has a carbon market, although it does have its issues. Also, individual nations in Europe are pledging to become carbon neutral, which means that they won't be adding CO2 to the atmosphere. Two examples of countries which have done that are Iceland and Norway. In the United States, several states have joined the Regional Greenhouse Gas Initiative, which is a carbon trading market in the effort to reduce emissions. These are, in dark red, Connecticut, Delaware, Maine, Maryland, Massachusetts, New Hampshire, New Jersey, New York, Rhode Island, and Vermont. Also, these states aren't the only states in the US that have joined forces to reduce their carbon emissions. There are many more examples of countries which are doing similar things. Unfortunately, it isn't enough to stop the increase in CO2. In fact, the measures that most countries have implemented do not go far enough to reduce emissions, nor are they reducing emissions fast enough, according to what our best research indicates. We do need an international treaty and coordinated approach to address this effectively. Australia isn't alone, and adding it all up means that they are making a difference. Also, notice that Monckton uses this argument in every single country he visits where they are considering implementing measures to reduce CO2 emissions.
And how much will it cost? Around 127 billion over the next 10 years. And if you were to apply the Gillard method all over the world, a method as cost ineffective as her proposals, then it would take $60,000 per head of the world population just in the next 10 years, or 60% of global GDP, just to forestall the 0.23 Celsius of global warming that the IPCC predicts will occur over the next 10 years. And it is clearly cheaper to do nothing about global warming and to adapt in a focused way to any consequences that are adverse that may occur from any warming that may occur than to spend any money whatsoever now. And that, if you do science by consensus, as Professor Dennis does, is the overwhelming consensus in the peer-reviewed economic literature. And it's the peer-reviewed literature that you find the true science in. And reviews of that literature by Lomborg in 2007 and Richard Toll in 2009 make it abundantly clear that the majority, in fact, a near unanimity among economists, show that it is greatly more expensive to try to intervene and to try, Canute-like, to tamper with the climate than simply to sit back, enjoy the sunshine, and adapt in a focused way as and if and only when necessary.
Lord Monckton made the following two points in this clip. 1. It is more expensive to prevent temperatures from rising than just adapting to the changes. 2. The majority of economists in the peer-reviewed literature agree that adapting to climate change is cheaper than preventing it. Firstly, adaptation to increasing temperatures is not cheaper than preventative measures, as this hinges for quite a big part on the world warming only by 1 degree by 2100. Such a low temperature increase goes against the climate sensitivity we have seen in reconstructions of past climates. I already stated that the vast majority shows that this is around the 3 degrees mark for doubling of CO2, the same number the IPCC uses. He mentions the carbon tax will cost Australia $127 billion. As I didn't know where he was getting this number from, I asked him what he used for it, and he provided me with the paper Is CO2 Mitigation Cost Effective?, written by him and published by the Science and Public Policy Institute. The first thing that I'd like to point out is that this isn't a peer-reviewed paper. This certainly shows, as there are a lot of issues with it. But the main one has to do with how he calculates the cost effectiveness of the Australian carbon tax. He calculates the cost of the tax against the increase in temperatures expected by 2020. A period that is way too short to see the effects of CO2 emissions. Another detail is that he uses the figure of $130 billion over a 10-year period compared to the $127 billion he mentioned in the debate. But this is just a minor detail, as there are several issues with this number he uses, but the biggest one is how he calculates the cost effectiveness in the paper, which is severely flawed. Monckton ignores the benefits, and this renders his cost effectiveness calculation essentially meaningless. He also cites two sources, Lomborg 2007 and Richard Toll 2009, in a manner which can easily be interpreted as meaning these are peer-reviewed sources by how he introduces them. Also, how he cites them is not enough to know what his exact sources are. Because of this, I cannot be sure which papers he cited, and Monckton never responded to my inquiries about this. However, I'm fairly sure what he's referring to with the Lomborg 2007 reference, as Lomborg published something in 2007, a book. Cool It, The Skeptical Environmentalist's Guide to Global Warming. This book is not part of the scientific literature, and it's a book that isn't known for its accuracy. As it goes way beyond the scope of this video to go through a book, I'll defer to the review by the economist Frank Eckerman. In it, he highlights several of the issues this book has with, for example, selective citation and thus misrepresenting the literature. He's by far not the only one who has been very critical of this book with how it represents this literature. The other citation Monckton gave, Richard Toll 2009, I did find publications for in the scientific literature, and I eventually did manage to trace down which paper Monckton is probably referring to, which this time is a peer-reviewed paper. However, the paper Monckton cited actually disagrees with him. I'll read a bit from the conclusion. A government that uses the same 3% discount rate for climate change as for other decisions should levy a carbon tax of $25 per metric ton of carbon, model value, to $50 per metric ton of carbon, mean value. A higher tax can be justified by an appeal to the high level of risk, especially of very negative outcomes, not captured in the standard estimates. There is a strong case for near-term action on climate change. Although prudence may dictate phasing in a higher cost of carbon over time, both to ease the transition and to give analysis the ongoing ability to evaluate costs, benefits, and policy mechanisms. The interesting part is that Australian carbon tax is priced at $23 per metric ton of carbon, which is cheaper than the $25 to $50 price mentioned in this paper. Which means that Monckton cited a paper that actually supports the Australian carbon tax. But let's ignore all this, and take a look at a real-world example of a carbon pricing and trading system, In 2008, 10 states in the US implemented a carbon cabin trade system to reduce the CO2 emissions made by the power sector by 10% by 2018. The states that are doing this are the previously mentioned Connecticut, Delaware, Maine, Maryland, Massachusetts, New Hampshire, New Jersey, New York, Rhode Island, and Vermont. All this is done via the Regional Greenhouse Gas Initiative, and they recently commissioned a study to examine the impacts of this cabin trade system. The results are broadly consistent with the economic study that predicted that benefits would outweigh the costs. For example, New Hampshire has a consumer energy saving of $60.6 million for an investment of $17.7 million. This means consumers now have millions more to spend and help stimulate the economy. We see such examples everywhere that implementing green technology pays off on its investments, often generating more jobs than, for example, the fossil fuel industry can. And we also see examples of green technology paying off for itself due to energy efficiency and reducing or eliminating the cost of fossil fuels. Because of this, there is actually a consensus among economists with climate change expertise that we should reduce greenhouse gas emissions. Economic studies consistently predict that benefits will outweigh the cost several times over. And that's the scientific consensus in economic literature on global warming.
And therefore, the carbon tax is the wrong solution to a non-problem. It has no place in the future of Australia. And what I should have liked to hear from the press of Australia is those pressmen speaking up for the heroes of labour, the mine workers who are menaced with the destruction of their jobs, the men who dig the darkness underground to bring us light. These great men, a dozen of whom joined me in the Hunter Valley on the platform when I spoke there last week and received a standing ovation from their terrified community, they want you, gentlemen of the press and ladies of the press, to speak for them. The coal workers, menaced by Prime Minister Brown with a destruction of their industry. And we too once had a Prime Minister called Brown, and we learned not to do that. So please speak up for your working people. The tie that I wear today, and I proudly wear today, is the tie of the Democratic Labour Party, Senator John Madigan's party. I had the privilege of spending yesterday with this great man. And here is a man who speaks for Labour, who speaks for the people who are going to be disadvantaged by this tax. These are the people who need your help.
What Monckton is arguing here is that this carbon tax will cost jobs in the Australian coal industry. If Australia moves away from using coal due to a switch towards renewable energy sources, then this will naturally cost jobs in the coal industry. And I understand that people who work in the industry are worried about their jobs. However, Monckton does not take into account the jobs that will be created in the renewable industry, jobs that can easily replace jobs lost in the coal industry, assuming all jobs in the coal industry will be lost. If we take, for example, Germany, and then only look at the jobs created by the deployment of photovoltaics, solar panels, there are over 40,000 people directly employed in the industry. This industry alone employs as many people as the entire coal industry in Australia. Both industries create just as many indirect jobs. Studies confirm that money invested in renewables creates more jobs than if you would invest the same amount in the fossil fuel industry. This can be up to 3 times as many jobs created compared to the same investment in the fossil industry. We have many more examples of real-life projects that save money and create more jobs than the fossil fuel industry does. Shifting from one technology to another will cause job losses in the oil industry, but has been shown time and time again in history that they will be replaced.
Not merely uncritically to accept consensus, but instead to ask the questions about the fraudulent science, which is in each of the conclusions of the three major IPCC reports. Ask questions about why it is that global warming is happening at the moment and has been happening over the last 60 years at only 1/5 of the rate now predicted by your government. Ask the question how, in science, there could be any chance that the rate of just roughly 1 Celsius per century of warming that has been occurring can suddenly become roughly 5 Celsius per century, as it were, overnight. There is no physical basis in science for any such sudden lurch in what has proven to be an immensely stable climate.
Here Monckton summarizes points he made during his opening statements for the debate. I'll ignore those for the moment, but he does expand on his claim that the world will only warm by 1 degree during this century. He's basing this on the claim that we've seen an increase of 0.1 degrees per decade, and if we then extrapolate this into the future, this means we can expect a warming of about 1 degree. The problem with this is that it's completely wrong, not in the sense that the figures he used are wrong, as they are very close to the actual figures, but in how he calculated the number is wrong. I've repeatedly mentioned that for a doubling of CO2 we can expect an increase in temperature of about 3 degrees. This is what scientists call the equilibrium climate sensitivity. What scientists mean with this is that if you increase CO2, this will introduce an energy imbalance. More energy is now absorbed in the planet than emitted. This is caused by the planet holding onto heat energy longer due to CO2, and this difference is what makes the planet warmer. After a while, the outgoing energy will again match the incoming energy, but the increase in temperature remains. And this increase is what scientists are talking about when they say that a doubling of CO2 will cause a warming of about 3 degrees. What Monckton did was project a trend. This doesn't tell you anything about the temperature the planet will eventually achieve. Also, one big problem with how Monckton calculated this is that it doesn't take into account thermal inertia. It just takes time for a planet to warm. For example, our oceans have been absorbing the vast amount of extra heat our planet is now holding onto. These oceans need to warm first before global temperatures can increase. His calculation also does not take into account that CO2 emissions have been increasing. This alone will mean that there will be more warming than Monckton predicts based on his figures. The climate system is far too complex to predict future global temperatures based on a trend projection.
And the people of Australia are frightened. They are frightened of their government. They are frightened of you. The world is also frightened. Australia is now regarded as a sovereign risk. Please, I beg you, do not merely accept consensus. Think. And think again. Thank you.
The claim that Australia is now regarded as a sovereign risk caught my attention. It's a very strange point. How would a carbon tax make a country a sovereign risk? Being considered a sovereign risk means that financial institutions overseas fear Australia will default on its debt and other payments. In the very least, it means that the perception this could happen has increased. I asked Monckton what he meant by this, and he pointed to the debt and budget deficit of Australia of the past 10 years. But this has nothing to do with the Australian carbon tax. Nor is it a correct assessment of the financial state of Australia. It is a country with a AAA rating, a GDP of 1.4 trillion, with a debt of just 27% of GDP. The statement Monckton made is not supported by the economic statistics that are available.
Ladies and gentlemen, We now turn to questions from our journalists in the audience. First question today is from Christian Kerr.
Christian Kerr from The Australian. A question to both our participants. Gentlemen, neither of you, as you have said, are scientists. Both of you have worked for very different politicians of very different philosophies. Today, aren't you just engaging in that old battle between laissez-faire and the central planners and the centrally controlled economy?
Lord Monckton.
Well, thank you very much indeed for that fascinating question, Christian. And indeed, you could say that I am by inclination a non-interventionist. However, let it be very clear, if anyone convinces me that the science points to an alarming and dangerous rate of global warming, then I will change my tune and I will say that perhaps we should try to do something about it, provided that it is cheaper to do something about it than to take the consequences of not doing something about it. One has to ask two questions here. One, is it going to warm at anything like the predicted rate? That is the only scientific question that really needs to be answered. And I have studied and indeed lectured at faculty level in the determination of climate sensitivity. I have written papers in the reviewed literature on the subject. So I do have some knowledge of it as a reasonably competent mathematician who has profited enormously by the use of mathematics over the years. The eternity puzzle that I launched here in Australia 12 years ago became puzzle of the year in Australia. I'm glad you all enjoyed it so much. But the central point here is that that's the first question: how much warming are we going to get? It is now blindingly obvious, if you look at the data and the evidence, that the rate of warming simply isn't enough to be sufficient. And even if it were enough to be sufficient, it is blindingly obvious that it is far, far cheaper. And this is the important point, far cheaper. In fact, something like 30 or 40 times cheaper to do nothing about it now than to try to forestall it by the vastly expensive methods that your government currently proposes. Thank you.
Most of what Monckton said here are claims I have addressed earlier, so I won't be going over them again. However, he does make two new claims in this section, which are: 1. That he has studied and lectured at faculty level on the determination of climate sensitivity. 2. That he has published research. In the first claim, it looks like he's implying that he has received some sort of official education on the subject of climate sensitivity. He doesn't say this explicitly, and it might just be an accidental suggestion. According to his own resume, he never received any official degree or education on the matter. If he meant personally studied the subject outside of an official education, then yes, this is true. He has been commenting and reading on the science for years. I'll give him the benefit of the doubt and assume he meant personal studies. However, it's not true that he has lectured on the subject of climate sensitivity, as lectured implies that he has lectured undergraduates, and possibly postgraduates, in a degree course lecture series. This is something that he never has done, and is the reason he never mentions this on his resume. His resume also states that he has a degree in classics and a journalism diploma. This means he is not even qualified to lecture on the subject, as he lacks the necessary degrees. But it's not unusual for universities to host guest lectures that present a new, different, or controversial viewpoint. This is what he has done, and probably is the source for this claim. However, how he said it doesn't convey this, but I'll give him the benefit of the doubt and assume he meant guest lectures. There's also the second claim made by him that he has published research. This gives the impression that he has published peer-reviewed papers in the scientific literature, something he hasn't done. Currently he has 0 peer-reviewed papers under his name. He does have several unreviewed publications, but nothing in the scientific literature. He does expand on the basis for this peer-reviewed claim, but as he mentions it later in the debate, I'll be talking about it then.
Next question is from Simon Gross.
Simon Gross from Science Media. Last week in the north of this town, we had an attack by some Greenpeace activists on a GM, an experimental plot of GM wheat. It reminded me of the symmetry between the public attitudes and acceptance or lack of when it comes to climate science and when it comes to GM plant science. In both cases, we have very strong scientific consensus. And in both cases, we have a small minority of people who are seen to be skeptics, deniers, ratbags, iconoclasts. So I just want to ask both of you, why is it uncool to be a climate science denier, but it's cool to be a GM science denier?
Well, hey, baby, I think that climate science skepticism is cool. And I think we ought to just mention a little bit about the history of Greenpeace, because it was founded, among others, by a friend of mine, the late Eric Ellington, who sadly died earlier this year. Now, Eric was a lovely man. He was totally non-political. He, like Patrick Moore and the other founders of Greenpeace, were true carers for the environment. They loved nature. They didn't want us to despoil it. They wanted to raise our consciousness of it, and they established Greenpeace to do just that. And with great sadness, this entirely non-political person said to me one day that he and many of his fellow founders of Greenpeace had had to leave the organization after a few years because, and this is how he put it, it had been taken over by Marxists who had not the slightest interest in the environment, but were willing to use it as a pretext for continuing the battle to bring down the West. So there is And this was one of the founders of Greenpeace. This is what he said. He's not the only one. Patrick Moore has publicly said what Eric has said to me privately. There is a feeling that these environmental movements have been captured by political forces who are not necessarily friendly to the West and our way of life. So that's one side of it.
It's not exactly a science claim, but one that is big enough to take a look at. One that confused me a bit in the beginning. The first person Monckton names, one Eric Ellington, isn't mentioned in any public records as one of the founders of Greenpeace. The only sources that mention Ellington as a founder can be traced back to Monckton. No secondary sources I can find are available to make the same claim, nor are there any sources linking his name to Greenpeace. I did manage to find public records on an Eric Ellington, a Scottish Society photographer. I contacted Monckton to check if I had indeed found the correct Eric Ellington, which he did confirm. It should be noted that he made an interesting mistake in the email that he sent me. In it, he also seems to be referring to Eric Ellington as an early member of Greenpeace. This might indicate that even Monckton is aware that Eric Ellington is not one of the founders of Greenpeace. The second person Monckton names, Patrick Moore, is a different story. Public records linking him to an early involvement with Greenpeace are available, particularly with Greenpeace Canada. But he's also not a founder of Greenpeace as it was founded in 1970. The letter where Moore states his desire to join Greenpeace was sent in 1971. Interesting enough, Monckton also refers to Moore as an early member of Greenpeace in his response to me. However, these are just minor details. The bigger problem is with the accusation by Patrick Moore that Greenpeace has been taken over by Marxists. One of the causes of this seems to be his rejection of the theory of anthropogenic global warming. Let me quote him from a letter addressed to the Royal Society. I am sure the Royal Society is aware of the difference between a hypothesis and a theory. It is clear the contention that human-induced CO2 emissions and rising CO2 levels in the global atmosphere are the cause of the present global warming trend is a hypothesis that has not yet been elevated to the level of proven theory. Causation has not been demonstrated in any conclusive way. This is just a start. He has described clear-cut logging as making clearings where new trees can grow in the sun. Moore also opines that clear-cut might mean the extinction of one species, but, and I quote, it provides an opportunity for a new species to take its place, end quote. He has also defended the company Asia Pulp and Paper, saying it engages in world-class sustainable forest management. This is the same company that has come under severe criticism for clear-cutting vast tracts of Indonesian rainforest and turning it into cheap paper. Very cheap paper, damaging the local ecosystem in the process. This is just a small sample of Moore's activities and statements. It's what puts Moore at odds with environmental organizations. Because his opinions are such at odds with these organizations, it has influenced how he sees them. He has said that they have abandoned science and logic in favor of emotion and sensationalism, and that environmentalism has become anti-globalization and anti-industry. I'm not saying that there are no people that have links with Marxism, or are actually against industrialization. Environmentalism is large enough that there are of course some more extreme elements in it. The Earth Liberation Front comes to mind. But the vast majority, including me, has absolutely no problem with industrialization. We want to work together with companies to create an economy that doesn't harm the environment. We want companies and communities to benefit from protecting their local environment and profiting from it. Just take a look at the following video about tuna fishing from Greenpeace for an example of this.
The Pacific is the last ocean where relatively healthy numbers of tuna still remain. More than 70% of the world's favorite fish is caught in these tropical waters. But the calm, clear Pacific Ocean belies a harsh reality. The once seemingly inexhaustible tuna stocks are under huge pressure from unsustainable and illegal fishing practices. Of the four commercially fished Pacific tuna species, yellowfin and big eye tuna are now in steep decline. And even the more resilient skipjack, the most commonly canned tuna, could soon be in serious trouble. Over the past decades, Pacific island nations have been selling fishing rights to foreign fleets who have been taking fish and profits elsewhere. But now, the Pacific is starting to develop its own fishing industry with a view to retain profits in the region and catch fish in a more responsible way. Greenpeace is promoting these more sustainable fishing techniques, such as catching free swimming schools and fishing by pole and line. These methods result in less bycatch of young tuna and non-target species such as sharks, and are therefore less harmful to tuna stocks and the wider ecosystem. On land, Greenpeace has pressured retailers and tuna brands to source their tuna from these more environmentally and socially responsible fisheries.
We have seen massive changes in the retail sector over the last few years, and there is an ever-increasing demand for sustainable tuna products from the consumers. We now need to eliminate unsustainable fishing practices from the supply chain and ensure that more of the economic benefits are staying with the Pacific Island countries.
For the people in the Pacific, fish is the most important source of food and jobs. And for their countries, tuna represents a crucial opportunity for economic development. Through its work in the Pacific, Greenpeace aims to safeguard a future for the tuna and the people who depend on it.
This is just one of the examples where Greenpeace helps stimulate a local sustainable industry that benefits the local economy and in turn the local inhabitants. This is a far cry from being a Marxist organization that is anti-business. There are valid points of criticism you can raise against Greenpeace, for example the GM issues, but accusing them of being taken over by Marxists is not one of them.
But then, as far as GM science is concerned, genetic modification has been practiced for decades in crops and has led, among other things, for instance, to what used to be called miracle rice when I was a lad learning about this in school. And we were taught to admire this because of the greater yields that the rice could achieve, and therefore the many starving people in Africa would be saved from suffering. So I think that what we've got to get back to is true science, whether it's for GM crops or whether it's the climate. No more of this nonsense about consensus. Back to the equations.
There's a small problem with Monckton learning about GM in school. Let me explain why. According to his resume, the last year he received an education was in 1974. The importance about this is that the technology of transgenics, what we know as genetic modification, was invented in 1973. The very first genetically modified organism was created in 1978. It was a bacteria modified to produce human insulin. The first genetically modified plants became available in the 80s, which were tobacco plants. The first genetically modified crop approved for commercial production I could find was the Flavor Saver tomato, which was approved in 1994. This means GM food crops have barely been in use for 2 decades, let alone since Monckton was a lad. But there was indeed a miracle rice developed in the 60s that has greater yields. The detail is, it's not a GM crop. All the new plants that were developed during the Green Revolution were the result of crossbreeding. I'm not entirely sure why he made this particular claim, as it wasn't even necessary to make his point that GM food crops are safe for human consumption. It's the consensus in the literature on this subject, which makes it strange that he takes a shot at the scientific consensus on global warming and climate change.
If I may ask a follow-on question following that, I heard you this morning on radio, and from my recollection is that you articulated that view about Greenpeace. My recollection is that you also suggested that the Greens, both in Europe and in this country, had been effectively hijacked by Marxists and the like, who had an economic agenda. Is that a view that you hold about the Greens in this country, that they predominantly have an economic agenda, which is to, as I think you put it, to destroy the West?
Let me suggest how you can study this question scientifically. Read the Communist Manifesto. It is available online. Read the manifestos of the European Communist parties in the post-war period. Read the manifesto of your own Green Party, and, sir, go figure.
For those that are familiar with the content of the Communist Manifesto and the positions of some of the Communist parties in Europe, will know that what Monckton is saying here is simply not true. The stated goals and principles of the Australian Green Party are not the same as these groups. Like I've said in a previous section, neither is the environmental movement inherently anti-business or anti-capitalism. Monckton perceives this as such and has even gone as far as saying that the intended goal is to establish a communist world government. Several versions of these arguments have been stated by him while being interviewed by Alex Jones. Yes, the Alex Jones of InfoWars and Prison Planet, who spreads the most outlandish conspiracy theories.
looking at this, being inside of it, watching it, what do you predict is going to happen? And if we lose this and they do get it ratified, then we start fighting it at the national level. What do you see happening?
Let me tell you what worries me about all this. What worries me is this, that this treaty has been through several negotiating rounds. And yet, although they've taken out the word government, because I've screamed at them and you've screamed at them and everybody's screamed at them, all the mechanisms of government, all the funding sources, the funding streams, as they call them, or funding windows is the latest phrase, sounds very coy, but actually it means ways of raiding the taxpayers' pockets. All of these things are still in place and have not only survived the previous draft, but have been considerably amplified. So what we're looking at is, I'm afraid there's no other way of putting this, it is a worldwide conspiracy by the governing class against the governed, by the big boys against the little guy, by the rich against the poor, by the strong against the weak. And if you're a little guy doing your honest job of work to protect and pay for your family, you have good reason to be very frightened at this moment. And if you think that our kind host and I have been winding each other up and frothing at the mouth about something that's just another global government conspiracy theory, I just have three words for you. Read the treaty. If you doubt in any way what I've been saying to you about the magnitude and breadth of the scope of this treaty, the powers and the wealth that it will transfer from you and your country to an alien, unelected, communistic bureaucracy with power to control all free markets worldwide, with the power to levy taxes on every financial transaction that crosses an international border. We're looking at an enormous, enormous communistic government which, in its sheer scale, is disproportionate to any conceivable threat from CO2, particularly now that we know by measurement that all of the UN's models were wrong and CO2 is simply harmless.
These arguments are what you will find if you dig into the Marxist and communist references Monckton gives. I find them very silly, as anyone who is familiar with the people involved, the organizations, the proposals themselves, and the science behind these proposals will know that the goal is most certainly not to establish a communist world government.
Next question, Andrew Tillett.
Andrew Tillett, The West Australian. A question for both of you, just about the tone of the debate about climate change, not the one here, but in the wider community, where it seems to degenerate into a lot of name-calling and mudslinging on both sides. And, I mean, we had, like, Lord Monckton's beginning of the trip, you were sort of overshadowed with the comments about Professor Garnaut, which you subsequently apologised for, but that prompted someone like Malcolm Turnbull to call you a rather sick vaudeville character.
That's better than he manages.
Are we getting? Is there going to be any hope of getting a more civilised tone to this debate, or has it become too polarised?
Yeah. First of all, ladies and gentlemen of the press, I hope that you would regard us as conducting a civilised debate here, and I should certainly like at this point to pay tribute to my opponent in this debate, who has conducted himself in an entirely civilised fashion, and I am going to try to do the same. So can we give him a round of applause? Now, I am concerned that 3 weeks before I arrived in Australia, one of your journalists said that climate sceptics should be branded with tattoos. I am concerned that 2 weeks before I came to Australia, one of your journalists on a leading national newspaper, in that national newspaper, said that climate sceptics should be gassed. Now, I wonder what kind of a regime it was that used to do that to its opponents. And what I'm particularly concerned about, ladies and gentlemen of the press, is that you have quite rightly called me out for a single, inadvertent, crass remark for which I have completely and abjectly and humbly and unreservedly apologized, and I renew that apology now, and yet you have not asked your own number, who have done similar things, in fact worse things, to apologize. And
Andrew, you say you work for the West Australian. Was this the paper whose headline a couple of weeks ago was "Ban the Lord" with a large picture of me? Was that a civilized tone? I'm not sure that it was. So let us all agree that in future this debate should be conducted at a more scientific level. It is not enough to wave our arms and say the science is clear when the climate is a chaotic object and therefore the science can never be clear. It's not good enough to say the science is clear because there's a consensus, because consensus is not the way science is done. Science is done by hard work, hard research, checking, checking, and checking again. Back to those equations again.
For those who aren't aware of what Monckton said that sparked the controversy, here's the relevant clip.
Professor Ross Garner, that again is a fascist point of view, that you merely accept authority without question. Heil Hitler, on we go.
He was way out of line with his remark, and it was the right choice of him to apologize for it. However, this is far from atypical behavior from Monckton. Another video of him making an offensive statement has also garnered some attention.
As far as I'm concerned, first of all, my name's Ben.
No, I'm not going to shake the hand of the Hitler Youth, I'm sorry.
Wow. Sir, as a Jew, I'm not really sure how I should take that.
I'll tell you how you should take it.
How should I take
you
that? Take my grandparents who escaped the Nazis growing up in Germany.
Because
please,
of the biofuel scam, world food prices have doubled.
Sir,
that is because of the global warming scare, which you won't look at the science of. And as a result of that, millions are dying in third world countries because food prices have doubled, because of the biofuel scam, because of the global warming scare.
Sorry,
not because there's been any global warming.
And I don't think biofuels are the right solution.
And until you start caring, I won't call you Hitler Youth if you ever again interrupt any meeting at which I am present where we are trying to have a private conversation.
You have just come out
here. Hey, it's fine.
Tough luck. Now you know what it looks like when you do robotic chants of the sort which the Hitler Youth used to do in Copenhagen when they occupied this city.
It's good, you know, not to try and drown out other people's opinions, and I do agree with that.
That's what the Hitler Youth did, and if you behave like the Hitler Youth, I'll call you what you are,
sir,
Hitler Youth.
Okay, well, having not been there last
like
night,
it,
regardless.
Or you lump it.
Okay, well, I'll let you know how I feel about that personally in a second. I'd like to tell you, though, that for as long as I've been alive, you know, the past 20 years, the science has been settled. And it's unfortunate that you haven't gotten on board the science of anthropogenic climate change.
All right,
I really
now,
truly
can you
believe
tell
that.
Me what has been settled then?
Sir, I believe that the global climate trend is that temperatures are rising. And if we look.
And so, have they been rising for the last 15 years?
Sir,
have they been rising for the last 15 years?
The greater trend is that they have been rising. And
yes,
that is the truth. That is
have
the truth. So, I'd like to give you my card.
No,
so, if you'd like to discuss this at some point.
The cards of Hitler Youth. No.
Sir, as a Jew, again, I think you can. This is. It's absurd,
I'm
and I'm
sorry.
Just getting a little frustrated.
As far as I'm aware, he never apologized for this behavior. These aren't isolated incidents. There are mild examples of this behavior already present in the sections of the debate that I've talked about. Outside of these particular incidents, he has made some very severe accusations. For example, of fraud towards scientists and opponents. Remember the court cases I talked about in the IPCC graph? He has repeatedly threatened critics with lawsuits for simply doing what I've been doing here, following opponent sources and claims. In my opinion, it's because of this Monckton isn't a person that should lecture anyone on civility in public discourse. But despite all of that, he does have a point. We should try to be as civil as possible when engaging with opponents. You don't have to sugarcoat everything you do and say, but language like this should not be used. It just distracts from the arguments being made.
Sam Cobble.
Hi, Sam Carville from Australian Associated Press. Sorry, Lord Monckton, you say that you should reject the consensus, but isn't a scientific consensus a consensus of evidence rather than a consensus of opinion? And you say that you're willing to be convinced. What would it take for you to be convinced that climate change was happening?
Right. First of all, climate change has been happening for the last 4,567 million years, since that Tuesday on which the world first formed and the first wisps of the atmosphere. So, of course, I do not deny that climate change is happening, nor do I deny that if we add CO2 to the atmosphere, some warming is likely to result. But as a specialist in the field of the determination of climate sensitivity, and I lecture on this, as I've said, at faculty level, I can assure you that there is no agreement among those scientists who have studied that question on how much warming there is going to be, and I have already adduced evidence from the Royal Society who have said exactly that in terms in their restatement of the science on climate just this year.
I really have to applaud Sam Cardwell for pointing out a very basic fact about the scientific consensus, that it is a consensus based on evidence and not opinion or some other ulterior motivation. Scientists go where the evidence leads them, they don't make the evidence fit their views. That's behavior that ends careers. During this part of the debate, he yet again asserts that climate sensitivity is low and that there is no consensus on how much warming a doubling of CO2 will cause. This is false. If you take a look at an overview of what the scientific literature says on climate sensitivity, you will see that they agree a lot. Generally, they are consistent with a range of 2 to 4.5 degrees warming for a doubling of CO2, the number the IPCC uses in their report. If he was a specialist on climate sensitivity, he should know this. There are very few papers that disagree with this vast majority in literature. Most of them are from so-called skeptics like Monckton and often are adult with problems. As Monckton uses a few of those papers later in the debate, I'll talk about those issues there.
So, science, if you're saying that a scientific consensus is somehow not a consensus of opinion, but a consensus of evidence, you have to say, and you did not say, what evidence you mean. On the evidence that I have seen, let us just take one example of it. If we go back to 1750, how much warming has there been since then? Well, using the Central England temperature record as a proxy for global temperatures, it's not bad for that purpose, it's at the right latitude, we've had 0.9 Celsius of warming in response to an addition of greenhouse gases to the atmosphere by us, which is almost equivalent to a doubling of CO2 concentration. That's going to give you around 1 Celsius of warming per doubling of CO2 concentration. Over the last 60 years, we again see 1 Celsius of warming per century happening. All the evidence points to 1 Celsius of warming for a doubling of CO2 and not the 3.3 predicted by the IPCC as its central estimate on current emissions or the 5.1 Celsius over the next 90 years predicted by your government. These are exaggerations which are not the consensus in the literature. And you should understand that the literature is much wider and reflects far more scientific opinions than many of you have been willing to allow or discover. Get on with your work.
This is again a repeat of the climate sensitivity calculation he used during his opening statement to make the case that a doubling of CO2 will only cause a warming of 1 degree. I already pointed out that the calculation itself is flawed, as it ignores, for example, temperature equilibrium, absorption of heat by the oceans, and increases in CO2 emissions, all of which will cause problems if you do a simple projection of a current trend into the future. But there is one new point made by Monckton in this section, which is that the Central England temperature record can be used as a proxy for global temperatures. What he said is analogous to saying that the population statistics of Ohio can be used to extrapolate population statistics for the entirety of the United States. You can't use a local data set as a proxy for global temperatures. You will get the wrong answer if you do this. Local temperatures and trends can significantly deviate from the global trend. As such, you cannot use them for global temperature trend calculations or for global climate sensitivity calculations.
Next question from Jennifer Bennett.
Hello, Jennifer Bennett from Campus Review. Question for Lord Monckton. You're often critical of climate change scientists because they don't like to go head-to-head with you in a public debate. Australian scientists have told us that a debate forum doesn't allow the time and format necessary for communicating complex information. If you're so certain of the facts, why not debate the scientists on their own terms? Why won't you submit the research you say you've undertaken to a quality peer-reviewed journal to be assessed?
I wonder why it is that Professor Tim Flannery, who knows no more about climate science than I do, is never asked that question. Why Al Gore is never asked that question. why Professor Stefan is never asked that question. And may I perhaps refer the Honourable Lady to Physics and Society for July 2008, where you will find an article entitled Climate Sensitivity Reconsidered. The author is Christopher Walter Monckton of Brenchley, and the article was indeed reviewed by Professor Alvin Saperstein, the Professor of Physics at Wayne State University, and also the review editor of the journal concerned at the time. The American Physical Society, yes, that's right. Indeed it does. So why don't you check with Professor Saperstein to find out whether he in fact reviewed it. Have you done that? No, I didn't think you had. Once again, please will you do your homework? What I'm saying is, if you take a preconceived position on this question, and therefore you don't check both sides of what you are told, rather than only checking my side because you're on the other side, then you will not get a balanced view on this question. The fact is that I am under no more obligation to publish in the peer-reviewed literature on this than anyone else. I have published in the reviewed literature. They try to say it wasn't peer review now, but they were perfectly happy to say it was peer review at the time. They were lent upon. This happens. You know, we too are sometimes victims of the other side going too far and putting too much pressure on. The two editors of that journal were sacked for publishing that paper. They shouldn't have been. It was a perfectly acceptable paper. There's not a lot wrong with it scientifically. And so read that if you want to see what my opinion is on climate sensitivity. It contains 30 relatively clear equations, each one of which the professor required me to justify in order that they could be included in the paper. It was a very thorough scientific review. Thank you.
Sorry, hello. Just to follow up.
Jennifer, I'm going to give Richard Wright a reply. Thank you.
Let me start by pointing out that if you try to explain what the science says to a layman audience to the best of your ability, like for example Al Gore, then you don't need to be peer-reviewed on these statements. What you're basing your arguments and statements on already is peer-reviewed, and if Al Gore would get the basis for it wrong, he will be criticized for it, as would anyone else, and rightly so. However, if you argue against scientific findings and propose something different, then you need to go through the literature to state your case. Monckton isn't doing that. He makes his case in debates like these and outside of the peer-reviewed literature. So this is a valid point of criticism towards Monckton. But he does say that he has published a peer-reviewed paper. The article he's referring to is Climate Sensitivity Reconsidered and was published in the newsletter of the American Physical Society. And due to Monckton constantly claiming this article is peer-reviewed, they saw the need to add the following statement. The following article has not undergone any scientific peer review, since that is not normal procedure for American Physical Society newsletters. They even went further than this disclaimer on Monckton's article. All subsequent submissions that are published in the newsletter section contain variants of the following statement. This contribution has not been peer-refereed. They represent solely the view of the author and not necessarily the views of APS. Mind you, similar statements have also been added to newsletter editions that were released prior to the article Monckton submitted. Quite the act to do if these newsletters contain peer-reviewed articles. This would have caused an uproar in the scientific community if papers suddenly were marked as non-peer-reviewed, but nobody, besides Monckton, raised objections to these changes. One of the pieces of evidence Monckton uses to show that his submission was peer-reviewed is a feedback document. If you read this document, it becomes apparent that the review was done by someone who isn't familiar with the subject, as shown by the following comment. I don't know the difference between forcing and feedback. If forcing is not just external energy flux, then I would assume it includes feedback. What do you mean? The reviewer apparently doesn't know how feedback and forcing work in our climate system, which is something a peer reviewer would know. The document also shows that it's just one reviewer. Peer review is normally done by multiple reviewers. Everything points to this just being an editorial review to make it readable and understandable for the target audience. The article also has some very big flaws that would have been caught during peer review. These flaws would have then been the reason the article would have been rejected for publication. Potholer 54 did a good rundown on one of the errors in the article.
First, let me explain some terms that you'll hear a lot. Put simply, forcing is the amount of warming caused by whatever might be warming the Earth. It could be the sun, or a greenhouse gas, or a light reflective surface turning into a darker one. The amount of forcing or warming due to a doubling of CO2 levels is pretty much agreed on by all climatologists. Richard Linson, the skeptic everyone likes to quote, says this figure is about 3.5 watts per square meter, as noted in the last three IPCC scientific assessments. The IPCC actually puts the figure at 3.7 watts per square meter, but there's a margin of error, so we're in the same ballpark. When forcing increases, the average global surface temperature rises until it reaches a stage where the amount of energy leaving the Earth is about the same as the amount of energy being pumped in by the forcing. This is called the equilibrium temperature, and in its most basic form it's very easy to work out. Temperature equals forcing times lambda, which is the Earth's sensitivity. It's usually written as delta T to denote a change in temperature in response to delta F, a change in forcing. So forcing is like a heater in a cabin, and sensitivity tells us the final temperature the cabin will reach in response to that heat. It's important to understand the difference between forcing and sensitivity, because as we'll see in a minute, Monckton gets them completely mixed up. In his piece in the Forum on Physics and Society newsletter, Monckton gives yet another figure for temperature rise, 0.58 degrees centigrade. Which one Monckton decides to settle on really doesn't matter, because we'll see that his calculation method is nonsense anyway. He laid it out in the APS newsletter piece. I'm not going to go over the whole thing, because people far better qualified than me have already done that. I'll just point out one of the most egregious errors that even the most scientifically illiterate can grasp. It concerns the figure for forcing, which Monckton initially puts at 3.405 watts per square meter. Okay, this is lower than the accepted estimate of 3.5 to 3.7, but never mind, that's small beer compared to what he does next. He divides it by 3. So he now gives us a forcing of just 1.135 watts per square meter. Monckton says this is to take account of the observed failure of the tropical mid-troposphere to warm as projected by the models, citing a paper by Richard Linson. But whether the tropical mid-troposphere warms as projected or not, this isn't forcing, it's sensitivity. Nowhere in the cited paper does Linson cut forcing. In fact, Linson specifically says in the same paper that forcing is 3.5 watts per square meter for a doubling of CO2. Nowhere near Monckton's 1.135. Surely no one who testifies to Congress on the subject of climate could possibly mix up sensitivity and forcing, especially in what he claims is his peer-reviewed paper. That would be like confusing time and distance, or pressure and volume. They're two completely different things.
Despite Monckton claiming his article's reviewed, it's definitely not. Even his own documents don't support the peer review claim. I doubt his article would have even passed peer review if it had been submitted.
Next question, Jacqueline Malley.
Jacqueline Malley from the Sydney Morning Herald. Lord Monckton, you said that the carbon tax is the wrong solution to a non-problem. I'm just interested in your views on the Coalition's direct action policy. It's also a proposed solution to what you say is a non-problem. Should the Coalition ditch it?
Yes, the Coalition should, in my opinion, ditch it, because there is no need to take any action about carbon dioxide at all. That is why Canada has announced that she is not going to participate in a Kyoto 2. Japan has announced the same. America has announced the same. China has announced that if she has a carbon tax at all, it will be at just $1.50 per tonne. Why, therefore, set your own working people at a huge disadvantage by imposing upon them a carbon tax at a rate which is unmatched anywhere else in the world and which most other countries are no longer going to pursue?
Monckton is suggesting here that these countries pulled out of Kyoto because they hold the position that no action is needed. Again, this is false. It is true that Canada stepped out of the Kyoto Protocol, but this isn't as simple as presented. One of the reasons they stated is that the Kyoto Protocol excludes two of the largest emitters in the world, namely the United States and China. Despite stepping out of Kyoto, they are still planning on reducing emissions by 70% below 2005 levels by 2020, as stated on their climate change website. Now let's take a look at Japan. It's fighting to get more support for reducing our CO2 emissions. They also state that they want to include the United States and China in future agreements on cuts in CO2 emissions. This is a far cry from what Monckton is suggesting here. China is also investing more and more in clean technology in an attempt to clean up pollution and lower their CO2 emissions. But they still have a long way to go. Same goes for the United States government, which has stated that action is needed. He also ignores the fact that other countries are working on reducing their emissions, something I already have mentioned. There are many initiatives and groups of countries working together to reduce emissions. Some of these have been active for over a decade. Australia is not alone in working to reduce the world's CO2 emissions.
It is not good enough merely to recite that there is a consensus of thousands of climate scientists. The number of climate scientists who, by measurement, observation, and experiment, and by the application of established theory to the results, have even attempted to determine climate sensitivity, which is how much warming we are going to get, numbers not in the thousands, but in the dozens. And most of those have concluded that the matter is indeed highly uncertain, and some of them, such as Professor Richard Lindzen and his colleague Yung Sang Choi, in a paper published earlier this year, have determined that the amount of outgoing radiation reaching space is far greater than that which would allow high climate sensitivity, and they estimate, once again, that there would be less than 1 Celsius degree of warming for a doubling of CO2 concentration.
Again, Monckton states that there is no consensus on how sensitive our planet is to a doubling of CO2, something that is simply not true. There is a consensus in the literature on what the number is. But here we get a glimpse as to why Monckton says otherwise. What Monckton did here is pick one paper that agrees with his position and ignores the vast majority of papers that don't confirm his position. This is called cherry-picking. The paper in question is called On the Observational Determination of Climate Sensitivity and Its Implications. It lists Richard S. Lindzen and Yung Sang Choi as its authors and was accepted for publication on the 22nd of May in 2011. This paper is an attempt to address severe flaws in the 2009 version of this paper. Lindzen has said that the 2009 version contained some stupid mistakes in his handling of satellite data, mistakes that he called embarrassing. One of the problems in the study was that Lindzen only used temperature data from the tropics, which he then used to calculate a global climate sensitivity for doubling of CO2. Remember my Ohio population analogy in one of the previous sections? This paper is the perfect example of why you don't do this. The problem is that the climate has a phenomenon called polar amplification. What this means is that as the world warms, it will do so more in the polar regions than in the tropics. Generally speaking, the tropics will warm the least compared to other locations in the world. It's an effect you see if you look at how much and where the world has warmed. This flaw, and many others, are the reason why this paper basically got torn to shreds in the scientific literature. The problem with the new 2011 version of this paper is that this problem, and several others, never were addressed. It's the reason the 2011 version was rejected for publication in the prestigious journals PNAS and AGU. For the PNAS submission, the peer review comments are publicly available, and all 4 reviewers said that the paper wasn't of suitable quality and the conclusions weren't justified. This is the reason the paper was ultimately submitted and published in an obscure Korean journal. The quality of the source Monckton cites here is very poor, and he ignored the vast majority of the literature on this matter. As such, his conclusions that climate sensitivity is low is not justified.
We might also cite Spencer and Braswell, 2010, who have said similar things, having at last measured the cloud feedback and found it to attenuate global warming by as much as the IPCC had thought it increased it.
And here Monckton yet again picks one of the few papers that agrees with his position. The so-called skeptics like Monckton often attack the best models we have. He did so in this very debate, where he said that all the science done by measurement and observation rather than by models suggests 1 Celsius degree for a doubling of CO2. Here's the relevant section of the debate where he said this.
And why do we think that we're going to suddenly get 3.3 Celsius for a doubling of CO2 concentration this century, that's the IPCC's central estimate, or 5.1, which is your government's central estimate, when all the science done by measurement and observation rather than by models, suggests just 1 Celsius degree.
The salient detail here is that the paper he cites uses a model to determine climate sensitivity, a very simple model. Unfortunately, it's too simple of a model to be used effectively, something Spencer has been criticized for. However, the biggest issue is with the suggestion in this paper that clouds will act as a strong negative feedback, meaning they would cool the planet. The problem with this is that it goes contrary to what we know about how clouds act on global temperatures. There's a lot of discussion on this subject, but no matter if it would amplify or negate some of the warming, the effect would be minor. Spencer hasn't been able to prove this via this paper or any subsequent papers. A lot of his research has been dismissed by other scientists due to some very basic errors. This again shows that the quality of the source Monckton cited is very poor, which undermines his argument that climate sensitivity is low.
And I could go on reciting paper after paper after paper, done by measurement and observation, which clearly establishes the strong likelihood that climate sensitivity is low. And therefore it is not acceptable to say the science is settled. You must read the literature and read it widely and understand that there is no consensus on this, there can be no consensus on this, and the way things are turning out at the moment, the likelihood of high climate sensitivity of any problem whatsoever with the climate is very small indeed. Richard.
The problem with the papers Monckton cites is that they are a small subset of what is available in the literature. I was already familiar with the ones he cited as they are part of a few papers the so-called skeptics, like Monckton, use. If you do read the literature broadly, the picture emerges that we do have a good idea what the climate sensitivity of our planet is. Yes, there are some uncertainties, but nothing like Monckton is trying to depict here. Another salient point is that if there is no consensus on what the climate sensitivity of our planet is, then why can Monckton assert that the likelihood of a high climate sensitivity is very small? Think about that for a moment, as these two points contradict each other.
Thank you. Next question from Alex Hart.
Alex Hart from the Seven Network. Sorry for interrupting there. I'm not sure if it's the right title to use, but my question is to Lord Monckton. I'm asking about a letter that was written to you by David Beamish from the UK. Clerk of the Parliament over there saying that he'd like you to stop claiming that you are a member of the House of Lords. What's your response to this? Will you stop using that title? Why or why not? And does it harm your credibility?
Sir, would you be kind enough to read out the words in this box on the passport page?
The holder is the Right Honourable Christopher Walter Viscount Monckton of Brenchley.
Thank you very much. The House of Lords says I'm not a member of it. My passport says I am. Get used to it.
To give you some context, let me read to you from the cease and desist letter that was sent on the 15th of July in 2011 by the Clerk of the Parliament. My predecessor, Sir Michael Parnell, wrote to you on the 21st of July 2010, and again on 30th of July in 2010, asking that you cease claiming to be a member of the House of Lords, either directly or by implication. It has been drawn to my attention that you continue to make such claims. I must repeat my predecessor's statement that you are not and have never been a member of the House of Lords. Your assertion that you are a member, but without the right to sit or vote, is a contradiction in terms. No one denies that you are, by virtue of your letter's patent, a peer. That is an entirely separate issue to membership of the House. This is borne out by the recent judgment in Baron Merriworth versus Ministry of Justice, Crown Office, where Mr. Justice Lewison stated, "In my judgment, the reference in the House of Lords Act of 1999 to a member of the House of Lords is simply a reference to the right to sit and vote in that House. In a nutshell, membership of the House of Lords means the right to sit and vote in that House. It does not mean entitlement to the dignity of a peerage. I must therefore again ask that you desist from claiming to be a member of the House of Lords, either directly or by implication, and also that you desist from claiming to be a member without the right to sit or vote." This very clearly states that Monckton isn't a member. The title on his passport only indicates that he is a peer that can be voted into the House of Lords. Before the House of Lords Act of 1999, the seats in the House of Lords were inherited. This did include Monckton's father, who lost his seat when the Act was passed. From that point on, his father had the same right as Monckton, to be voted in for a vacant seat. Monckton inherited this right when his father passed away in 2006. And it's since 2006 that Monckton has been claiming that he's a member of the House of Lords. But despite Monckton offering himself as a candidate for a vacant seat, he has failed to secure one each time. Though Monckton has offered himself as a candidate, he has publicly stated that he sees the House of Lords Act as flawed and unconstitutional. According to him, this means his letter's patent makes him a member of the House of Lords, just not with the right to sit and vote. That is the reason he claims that he is a member of the House of Lords. But the cease and desist letter I just quoted very clearly states that having a letter's patent doesn't mean you're a member of the House of Lords, as that means you were voted in for a seat, Monckton has peerage and doesn't have a seat. Until Monckton can make his case in court and win this case that the act is flawed and unconstitutional, he cannot claim to be a member.
What I will do, therefore, since I had, as a condition of taking part in this debate, insisted that ad hominem questions of that futile and drivelling kind should not be asked, I'm going to take a free kick and I'm going to get back to the climate, which is what we are here to debate, not the way the House of Lords works. The IPCC's, the IPCC's estimates of the amount of warming from a doubling of CO2 concentration, 2 to 4.5 Celsius, with a central estimate 3.26 Celsius, suggest a feedback loop gain in the climate system of between 0.42 and 0.74, with a central estimate 0.64. However, that is a near impossibility, physically speaking, because in any object on which feedbacks operate, if the feedback loop gain is greater than somewhere in a range of 0.01 to 0.1, the object becomes terminally unstable, and under conditions which might quite easily occur, the loop gain would reach 1 and the system would blow itself apart. Since this hasn't happened, we have a very good evidence from process engineering in this case that once again the likely rate of warming for a doubling of CO2 is 1 Celsius degree. Thank you.
This is complete nonsense what Monckton said. You cannot use a concept like this to prove that our planet has a low climate sensitivity. The mathematics he's referring to with process engineering are formulas dealing with feedback in an electronic circuit. I don't think that I have to explain why this wouldn't be applicable to the climate, nor would it be used by a climate scientist. Besides, from climate science itself we can show that what he's saying is wrong. In climate science we use a law called the Stefan-Boltzmann law. It describes the main and powerful negative feedback in how our planet responds to a forcer. I'll spare you the math. But what it describes is how heat escapes our planet and how you can calculate how much is escaping. What Monckton described simply isn't possible with the climate sensitivity used by the IPCC, nor a possibility with the use emission scenarios. Our planet is simply nowhere near this kind of tipping point.
And a final question today from Mark Kenny.
Mark Kenny from the Advertiser. Lord Monckton, I'll take it from your response to Mr. Hart's question that you reject that letter from the House of Lords.
I've told them it's impertinent and they should put my reply on their website. They have not so far found the courage to answer.
All right. Look, can I ask you a question which I guess is a first principles question that would have been better asked earlier, but would you like to see companies and individuals put less pollution skyward than is the case now and than will be the case with a growing population, or are you unconcerned about it?
Right, let us distinguish between pollution, which usually means particulate pollution such as soot, or the emission of carbon dioxide, which on any view is not a pollutant. It is plant and tree food. If we were able to manage a doubling of CO2 concentration this century, which is what I expect to happen regardless of the carbon tax, then what we would find is that at the end of the century, the yield of certain staple crops would rise by up to 40%, and they would be able to survive on less water as well. The greening of the planet in the 30 years since satellites have been watching, as a result of what is known as CO2 fertilization, is absolutely wonderful. It's actually gone up by 6%. The net primary productivity of plants has risen by 6%. So CO2, if you really are a green and you really want to green the planet, is the way to go.
When I asked Monckton what the basis was for the claim that productivity of staple crops would increase by 40% by the end of the century, he couldn't provide it to me. The only thing he could give me was that he heard this number during a presentation by Dr. Leighton Stewart at the Alternative Climate Conference on Sunday, December 6, in 2009. This was an event where a very select group had access to. For the presentation held by Dr. Stewart, I couldn't find any transcripts or other materials, nor was there a response from Dr. Stewart to my inquiries for more information. Monckton also didn't remember anything about how this number was calculated or sourced. This means he has been repeating a number he doesn't know the basis for. However, let's focus on the numbers and statements made by Monckton, and by now it probably isn't a surprise that they are either incorrect or stretch a fact beyond what it is capable of being used for. It is true that CO2 in higher concentration can, and will, act as a fertilizer. For this very reason, adding CO2 in greenhouses is used to increase productivity. But the 40% increase in productivity is way beyond what has been demonstrated as achievable by experiments outside of greenhouses. For plants like wheat, soybeans and rice, the increase in productivity on average was found to be at 13%. For plants like corn and sugarcane, it's 0%. The difference between the plants I mentioned is caused by how they use CO2 during photosynthesis. This is just a direct effect of CO2, which is already a lot lower than the number cited by Monckton. The advantage of CO2 fertilization is lost when you start to take into account the indirect effects more CO2 will have. There are many secondary effects, but I'll take just temperature as an example. If we double CO2, the planet will warm, according to the IPCC, by about 3 degrees Celsius. And here's where the statement by Monckton that plants would be able to survive on less water will play a role. It is true that plants use less water if there's more CO2. However, this is a double-edged sword. Plants also use water to cool themselves. If temperatures go up, this means the plants will experience more heat stress, which reduces productivity. If you start taking into account how weather and precipitation will change due to the increase in temperature, it becomes even more obvious that this increase in productivity is not achievable. The drought the US has been experiencing is what has been predicted by climate models. And if we keep increasing CO2 in the atmosphere, it is very likely to produce devastating droughts in the grain belt. Saying that CO2 is a fertilizer doesn't mean that there isn't a point where the effects become negative instead of positive. But he did get the 6% increase in total global plant productivity correct. He probably got this from the paper Climate-Driven Increases in Global Terrestrial Net Primary Production from 1982 to 1999, which was published in 2003. Unfortunately, the droughts we've seen during the past warmest decade on record have already caused a slight decrease in productivity. Results like this, combined with more advanced research on plants, is why scientists are saying that the increase in CO2 is not a good thing for food production. After watching this debate, people tend to point to Monckton as the winner. It was especially hailed as such among the so-called skeptics on the internet. If you had watched this debate in its entirety before this analysis, you might have walked away with the idea that global warming isn't something you should worry about. Or it would probably have made you more wary about the prevailing views and scientific findings. This is something I can fully understand. Monckton is bold, assertive, and well-spoken. He's sure of his argumentation and brings him with a certain flair. During this debate, he's able to cite papers and bring out other supporting materials for his position. In short, he's a very good debater and is truly in his element in such debates. However, a debate does not lend itself well to fact-checking what the participants say. Opponents or the audience will not be able to look up your sources and check if they confirm what you say. Even after a debate, it's not easy to verify statements and arguments for audience members. Anyone who wants to attempt that for this debate would be faced with the Herculean task of going through about 30 minutes of video for just one of the participants. Most people simply do not have the time to go through all the arguments presented or trace down all the material cited and read up on what is written in scientific literature. As I've actually done this, I can assure you this is a very big project, even if you're already familiar with the subject. After undertaking this journey, I'm shocked at how incorrect Monckton was. I've tried, truly tried, to find sections where he is correct or where I agree with his conclusions. But, as you might have already surmised, there are just a few instances where this has happened. Even when Monckton has a point or is factually correct, he often gets something wrong. The best example of this is when he made the point that GM crops are safe for human consumption. The statement is correct, as it is the consensus in the literature. But then he uses a rice variant that isn't a GM crop to support his argumentation and gets the date of when GM crops became available wrong by decades. This was one of the biggest surprises for me during this analysis, as I agreed with Monckton when he made this point. I never expected that I would end up pointing out major flaws in his argumentation. Things like this are indicative of the problems he has with having a good and correct understanding of the science on climate change. The same goes for his railing against the scientific consensus on global warming, as a scientific consensus is based on evidence. It reflects our best understanding of the subject at hand. Basically, for every question in science and scientific discipline, there is a consensus. The current consensus for global warming is that it is real, that predictions are coming true, and it's not uncommon that they are worse than expected by scientists. The vast majority of them say we need to take action to avoid the worst-case scenario so that we do not create a vastly different world. The often flawed arguments and statements made by the so-called skeptics like Monckton do not change this. I'm also not the only person who did his homework on Monckton's claims and argumentation. There are many more out there, and all of them show huge problems and mistakes. Because of this, I don't see Monckton as a reliable source for information. The very basic mistakes he often makes can, in my opinion, be used to outright dismiss anything he says. I would not recommend accepting anything as true without some due diligence and fact-checking. Suffice to say that Monckton isn't a reliable source for correct information on climate change and global warming. Simply based on the amount of errors he made during this debate should have meant that he had lost the debate. I hope you have found this analysis interesting and maybe even enjoyable. I hope you will at least walk away with a greater understanding of the different arguments and what they are based on, no matter which position you have.